Section 1. You will hear a man arranging to get a telephone connection. First, you have some time to look at questions 1 to 4. You will see that there is an example that has been done for you. On this occasion only, the conversation relating to this will be played first.
This is the ClearPoint Telephone Company customer service office. My name is Ms. Jones. How may I help you?
Yes, I'm moving and I'd like to arrange to have a phone line installed. The woman answers the phone. This is the ClearPoint Telephone Company customer service office. So the words telephone company have been written at the top of the form. Now we shall begin. You should answer the questions as you listen, because you will not hear the recording a second time. Listen carefully and answer questions 1 to 4.
This is the ClearPoint Telephone Company customer service office. My name is Ms. Jones. How may I help you?
Yes, I'm moving and I'd like to arrange to have a phone line installed.
Of course. Let me get some information from you first. May I have your name, please?
It's Kramer, Harold Kramer.
And would you spell your last name for me, please?
K-R-A-M-E-R.
M-E-R. Got it. Okay. Could I have the address where you'd like to have the telephone connected?
That would be number 58 Fulton Avenue, apartment 12.
Is that a business or a residence?
A residence. It's my new home address.
Then the type of phone service you want is residential, not business?
Yes, yes. It's for my home.
All right, fine. Now, let me get your employment information. Who is your current employer?
I work at the Wrightsville Medical Group.
Then your occupation is doctor?
No, I work for the doctors. I'm the office manager. Now listen and answer questions 5 to 10.
Okay, and could I have your work phone number?
It's 637-555-9014.
9014, great. Just one more thing. I need to know how long you've been at your current job.
I've been working there for quite a while now. Let me see. 9 years.
Okay, good. You've been there long enough, so I don't need to ask about any other work history. Now, in addition to our basic phone service, we have several special services available.
Could you explain them to me?
Most customers opt for unlimited long-distance service. It really saves you money if you make a lot of long-distance calls.
That sounds like a good idea.
Then I'll put you down for long-distance service. Another popular service is voicemail. Voicemail takes all your messages electronically, and all it takes is one simple phone call to retrieve them.
Voicemail. No, I don't think so. I have an answering machine to take my messages. It's old, but it still works fine.
We also provide internet service if you're interested in that.
I am. Please put me down for internet as well as phone service.
Right. Okay, I think we're almost finished. I just need to schedule a time for the technician to go to your apartment and do the installation. Let me see. What about next Tuesday? Would that work for you?
No, not Tuesday. I'll be at a conference all day. Wednesday would work, though.
I'm afraid I won't have any technicians in your area on Wednesday. I could send someone on Friday.
That would be fine.
What time of day works best for you? Morning or afternoon?
Morning would be best.
All right, then. It's on the schedule. Do you have any questions?
No, I don't think so.
Thank you for calling ClearPoint.
That is the end of Section 1. You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turn to Section 2. Section 2. You'll hear someone talking to a group of university students. First, you have some time to look at questions 11 to 17. Now listen carefully and answer questions 11 to 17.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Upton University. I hope you are settling in and beginning to find your way around. I know how confusing it can be when you start life at university, and that's why we have Freshers Week to help you find your feet. Before I go any further, I should perhaps introduce myself. My name is Sally Jackson, and I am the secretary of the Students' Union, which has organized this week of events for you. You will usually find me in the office on the first floor of this building when I'm not attending lectures. Anyway, down to business. Of course, there are a few things that you are obliged to get done during your first week here. But once you've opened a bank account, if you haven't got one already, seen your director of studies to discuss which courses you are going to take, and signed up with a doctor, there will be plenty of time left to enjoy the events we have arranged for the week. And have we got a lot lined up for you? Throughout the week from Monday to Friday, every morning starting at 10 a.m., there will be orientation and welfare events. These will include tours of the campus, which, as you have probably noticed, is the size of a small town with 9,000 residential students, as well as sessions on developing study skills. We also have tours of Upton itself arranged for you, with a bus leaving from outside this building every afternoon at 5 o'clock. There are a number of interesting things to do and see in and around Upton, so you can expect visits to the castle and museum, as well as the popular Ghost Walk. You'll need to sign up for this one, as numbers are limited. Just put your name on the list on the notice board in the entrance lobby. An important event is scheduled for Monday, that's the day after tomorrow, when we will be holding the academic fair. This is an opportunity for you to speak to students and academic staff about the courses that are on offer. The academic fair starts at 1 o'clock, by the way. There are a couple of other fairs that I think will interest you. First of all, we have the Society's Fair on Tuesday the 16th, which I think is an absolute must. You might not believe it, but the university has over 150 societies and sports clubs you can sign up for, so you are sure to find something of interest to you. That also starts at 1 o'clock, and it will be here in the Union Building. Also in this building is the trade fair on Wednesday from 2 until 5 in the afternoon. This one might sound a bit strange because you will find a load of banks and other businesses here trying to get your custom. You will find plenty of bargains and, best of all, a lot of the businesses give away stuff for free.
Before you hear the rest of the talk, you have some time to look at questions 18 to 20. Now listen and answer questions 18 to 20.
We've also got a great entertainment program lined up for you, starting tonight with our welcoming party. We have a top band lined up for your entertainment, but I'm not allowed to say who they are. All I can say is that I am sure you will not be disappointed. So come along to Blackmore Hall at 9 o'clock this evening to get your university experience off to a flying start. Just one point. I'm afraid this event is limited to freshers only. Because of space restrictions, you can't bring a friend tonight. Sorry about that. There's more fun and games on Monday in the Cotswold Theater here on campus. We have booked two of the cleverest comedians in the country, Paul Frazier and Jenny Brown, for a three-hour show. Paul has assured us that he and Jenny have packed the show with new material, and as they always get rave reviews for their shows, I think we can look forward to an evening of great entertainment. That's in the Cotswold Theater on Monday evening at 7:30. Moving along a bit, on Thursday, there is an important date for your diaries. This is the official Freshers opening ceremony, when the dean welcomes you to Upton University. So remember, Thursday the 18th from 2:30 to 3:30 in Blackmore Hall. You certainly should go to this one, and by the way, light refreshments will be available. At the end of the week, on Saturday, you have the chance to dress up in your smartest evening wear for the official Freshers' Ball. Actually, although it's called a ball, it is quite a relaxed affair, so we are more than happy if you turn up wearing jeans and a t-shirt. The important thing is to relax and enjoy yourselves. Time and place are the same as for this evening's party. Blackmore Hall from 9 in the evening to 3 o'clock in the morning. Right. I think I've covered the most important and exciting events we have lined up for you, but there will be plenty of other things going on throughout the week, so remember to check the notice board in the entrance lobby regularly. Enjoy the rest of the day, and I look forward to meeting as many of you as possible this evening at the welcoming party.
That is the end of Section 2. You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turn to Section 3. Section 3. You will hear a discussion between two students and their teacher on a planned charity event. First, you have some time to look at questions 21 to 25. Now listen carefully and answer questions 21 to 25.
So, are you making any progress with your plans for our annual charity event? I guess first things first, have you decided what charity it will be in aid of this year?
We're thinking about Help the Children Africa, sir.
Well, that's Mark's idea, sir, but I myself prefer a local charity called the Meals on Wheels.
I'd have to agree with Laura on this one, Mark. After all, we're supposed to be giving back to the local community, and although helping African children is a very worthy cause, it's a little outside our remit.
That settles it, I guess.
Moving on from the beneficiary question, have you made a decision on what type of event it will be?
Yes, we plan on doing something a little different this year. We're calling the event Balloonathon. Basically, we're going to offer balloons for sale to all the students.
Balloons? I don't see where you're going with this. Why would they want to buy a balloon?
Well, here's the thing. We don't actually give them the balloon. Instead, we'll write their name on it along with a special phone number and then we'll release all the balloons into the air. When they fall to the ground, if a person finds one and rings a special number, then both he and the student who bought the balloon will win a gift voucher.
That sounds like an excellent idea, guys. Well thought out. This balloonathon has a real novelty value attached to it, don't you think?
Exactly what we said, sir.
The only drawback is that the gas you put into the balloons is rather expensive.
How much?
About £20 per canister, and we'll need about 10.
And how many balloons are you planning to blow up?
Well, there are over 1,000 students in the school, so if even one third of the students buy one, we'd need about 350 balloons. We've decided to order 500 so we don't run out. The good thing is we can return the canisters of gas if we don't use them, and the balloons aren't expensive, so there's no real risk of us spending a lot of money without getting a good return.
You two have really thought this one out. I'm impressed.
Before you hear the rest of the discussion, you have some time to look at questions 26 to 30. Now listen and answer questions 26 to 30.
Thank you, sir.
So, how much money do you think we can raise?
Well, each balloon costs about 1p, and when it's filled with gas, it's going to cost us about 50 pence. We reckon that if we sell our balloons at a price of £1.50 and we sell all 500 of them, we'll end up making a profit of £1 per balloon. So that's £500 in total.
That's fantastic.
And it gets better, sir. We've secured a sponsor for our event who's going to give us £1,000.
How did you find a sponsor?
The balloon company we approached about buying the balloons asked us if we'd be interested in letting them sponsor us too.
What's in it for them?
They're going to print their logo on every balloon.
I think you've done a good deal there.
Thank you, sir. So, do we have your approval to confirm our order?
Absolutely. But, you know, I think we can sell more balloons if we set our minds to it. So why not order double the amount? 1,000 instead of 500.
We're going to need more than 10 canisters of gas, then.
Double the amount, presumably.
Correct.
OK, let's go for it. Let's make this year's charity event our most successful ever.
That's the end of section 3. You have half a minute to check your answers.
Section 4. You will hear a lecture about the history of the tomato. First, you have some time to look at questions 31 to 35. Now listen carefully and answer questions 31 to 35.
The tomato is a popular vegetable, which figures in the cuisine of many countries around the world. It is particularly prominent in Italian cooking, but it was unknown in Europe until Spanish explorers brought it back from the Americas. The tomato originated in the highlands of Peru. From there, it eventually found its way to Mexico, where it was cultivated by the Aztecs. The Aztec tomato wasn't the large red vegetable we know today. Rather, it was small and yellow. When this small round fruit arrived in Italy, it was named golden apple for its bright yellow color. You'll notice I just called it a fruit. That's because a tomato is botanically a fruit, even though most everyone calls it a vegetable. The actual word tomato comes from the Aztec name for the vegetable, meaning plump thing. The tomato arrived in Europe in the 1500s and quickly became a popular food in Spain and Italy. In the late 1600s, the Italians began publishing recipes that used tomatoes. The British, however, had a different attitude toward the vegetable. It was grown as an ornamental plant in Britain in the 1600s, but it wasn't eaten because it was thought to be poisonous. It wasn't until the 1700s that tomatoes became part of the daily diet in Britain.
Now listen carefully and answer questions 36 to 40.
In the United States, tomatoes were also used as ornamental plants rather than as food for a long time. This attitude began to change in the 1800s. In 1806, a gardener's calendar mentioned that tomatoes could be used to improve the flavor of soups and other foods. Thomas Jefferson did much to enhance the tomato's reputation as a food. He first served tomatoes to visitors at his home in Virginia in 1809. Then in 1820, a man named Robert Gibbon Johnson decided it was time to discard once and for all the idea that tomatoes were poisonous. To prove his point, he ate 1 kilo of ripe red tomatoes in public. 2,000 people gathered to watch this feat, which took place on the steps of the courthouse in Salem, Massachusetts. Amazingly enough, Johnson survived this stunt. The popularity of the tomato as a food began growing rapidly. Soon, people all around the country were eating tomatoes. By the 1830s, American newspapers and magazines were publishing thousands of tomato recipes. However, all those recipes involved using tomatoes in some cooked form. Tomato salads and sandwiches were still unknown. It wasn't until a century later in the 1930s that it became popular for people to eat raw tomatoes.
That is the end of Section 4. You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Thank you.